I'm sure you're really a wonderful cook, a terrific cook, really.
There's always truth behind every piece of humor. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm a lousy cook. And when I do cook, when I do have guests, it never works out right. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, Liberace will come over, I'll serve him fruit cup, and then you go, mistake. That, you know, Stacey Keach got porridge. I mean, it's the whole thing. Madonna came over. I served her a tartan crabs. It was just...
I'm sure you're able to smooth the whole thing over, that, you know, with your charm.
No, with my I used to be a waitress.
Really? Well, I was a waiter.
Come on.
No, when I was at college, university.
I was a waitress when I went to university. Are you serious?
Well, you could. Yeah, I was a waiter.
Were you
for
a good
about
waiter?
8 weeks. I was a good waiter, I think, but I learnt to despise customers because they were so idiotic. I had no idea that customers were so idiotic.
How?
And ever since then, I've always sort of sympathised with waiters. Well, people come in. I was working in this little restaurant in the West Country. Come in, sit down, you give them the menu and give them the drinks they want, right? And you come back about 3 minutes later, 5 minutes later, ask what they want to have. And they'll say things like, is the fish good tonight? As if you are going to say, no, it is 3 days old, it is filled with maggots, and so on. I think waiters have a hard job.
I was a waitress with Lily Tomlin. She's known over here, right? We were two waitresses
yes,
together.
Yes, Ernestine, on the telephone. Yeah.
And we used to do jokes. See, we got fired. They would say things like, what's the catch of the day? And we'd go, herpes. And they just... We were fired. We were crying. But we would make jokes. Because you want to make jokes.
Yeah, yes. I said, do you have the white Mac on? And you say, no, just my ordinary clothes. You know, wine.
Let's get on with the show.
Why not?
Okay, I'm thrilled to meet this first guest. He is a man I have longed to meet. I've longed to work with him. We always miss each other at parties. I think he's the best comedy actor in films today. He's just incredible. But the first time I saw him was on a stage in New York City with Peter Cook. There have been some great doubles acts in our time. There's been Abbott and Costello, there's been Laurel and Hardy, there's been Samantha Fox. But today, I'm pleased to bring back your old partner, and I hope my new friend, Mr. Dudley Moore.
Here we are.
You are.
Yes.
And the last time I saw the two of you professionally was in New York City on stage. How long ago was that?
Well, 73, we were there for a year.
For a year.
14 months, actually, wasn't it?
14 months, I think, Dudley, yes. You'll find. If you... Remains of your mind, yes, 14 yes. months we were there.
Yes,
and then all
sheer,
over the country.
Sheer bliss.
Was it hard breaking up?
Well, I never felt we broke up so much as sort of slid away from that's each other in the inevitability of life's thing.
Well, what happened was that you stayed on in America and I came back here.
Yes, I actually...
Sort of split us up a
yes,
bit.
that was it, really. I was with Tuesday Weld at the time. We'd been together for about a year, and we ended up doing the show in Los Angeles, and Tuesday wanted to do some more film work, and so we ended up living there for a while, and I gradually got attached to Los Angeles and her.
Yes.
And and that's how it happened. It wasn't anything very much more sinister than that.
I'm going to ask both of you this, independently. What was the nicest thing about him? What was the worst thing about him? Let's just go for the worst.
This is like a golfer, you know. Yes. He knows, just as you're going to do your stroke, he lights his cigarette. The nicest thing about him was that he was very jolly and very, very full of humor. I like that. He seemed to be very unflappable. And drifted on over the years through some of the minor maelstroms that the four of us hit. The nastiest thing about him... Oh, blimey.
Just spit it out.
I can't think what was the nastiest thing. When we met, I wasn't aware of it. He was an angel. I can't think, actually. We didn't really know each other well enough to know the nasty things, but they... And in fact, we went on to enjoy each other's performances so much that we became a team. So there wasn't a nasty side to it, really.
What about you? What was the nicest thing about him and The least nicest.
The nicest thing about Dudley at the time, and it remains today, is his ability to lie through his teeth smiling. I mean, that has been so charming and flattering about me, and I could be a right bastard.
are you thrilled that you become a sex symbol? Did you ever think... No, but you have. You know... Oh, come on. After 10, your whole career flipped around.
Yes,
and you became
true.
A sex... You're playing against these... Well, perhaps not against, but you're playing with...
Playing into.
Into. Well, perhaps...
I think I was... I just got a, you know... It sort of rubbed off on me, if you'll pardon me. I mean, I'm not a sex symbol. I mean, I'm not somebody who is symbolic of sex. I don't walk around and people suddenly drop their drawers and... I mean, I think of Robert Redford as a sex symbol. He's more of a mythological creature. I'm not really.
But yet, look at the women you've played with on... Bo Derek.
Yes.
Was she fun, as much fun as she appears?
Yeah.
Not the smartest if you've ever spoken to him.
Joan.
She thinks we
I
just...
keep muddling you up with Bo. Bo.
But she is a darling.
Well, she's very nice. And
she thinks you just finished World War 11.
Yeah, but I don't know why you imagine that you have to be an academic to be nice. I never look for academia. I don't expect to practice nuclear physics with the person I'm living with.
But sooner or later, you've got to sit up and discuss something.
No, well, not necessarily. I think... Maybe in your case, Joan, I mean... I look very much for... Look at this, I'm doing this. I have a friend called Brogan Lane, who is somebody I've been with for the last 7 months, 8 months.
So why don't you get married? How old are you now?
I'm 50.
Did that get you crazy?
I'm 50.
Does that get you crazy?
Well, being 50?
Yes, that was. It's a big. I was.
Oh well, I thought I was going to go into a motel room, lie down and sob. You know, as I watched the second hand go around. But it was such a drab experience altogether. But suddenly I'm 50, and that was it. You know, nothing happened, and so it was a really unmomentous occasion. Unlike 30, where I've nearly killed myself. I'm so depressed.
Isn't that funny? 30 was the bad one for you.
Yeah.
50 was the bad one for me. I just went, oh, I'm like a woman out of Edith Wharton. I'll just go and become gray now. It's very, very hard. But harder for a woman, because men like them very young. How
they
old
do?
Is Brogan?
She's 25.
Well, then why should you say they do?
Why do I say what?
Yeah, then men like young women.
No, I like an old hag of about 99. there's so few of them about.
You're going to get letters now. You're going to have to answer.
I'll answer anything from somebody who's 99. I just happen to be very happy with Brogan. She's a decent, nice woman, and we have a wonderful sort of easy relationship. It's peaceful, you know. Which is nice. She introduces me to things that I've never done before. She took me white water rafting, which I've never done before. She made me ski, which I never did before. She's snapping me as I go down the slope, which was great.
That's great.
Every now and again, I'm standing on the slopes, you know, talking to the instructor, and there's, boom, and there's a little five-year-old head in between my legs, you know. They slip down, you don't hear them till the last moment. I thought it'd be a marvelous way for pregnant women to give birth. You know, you just shove them down the slope, the husband stands there, and they go, boom, and the baby flies out. Shears trying to get the umbilical cord. Sometimes.
We have a clip of the two of you from years ago. Would you like to see yourself?
I'd love to see.
It's a 20-year-old clip. It would be fun to see.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what's even worse, Dad, than the Laughing Cavalier.
What's that, Pete?
Can you think of anything worse?
No,
there
Pete.
Is something worse than the Laughing Cavalier, which my Auntie Muriel has. She has the bloody Mona Lisa in her...
In her toilet, yes.
That's dreadful. That awful sniffy look about her, looking so superior, you know, peering down at you. She looks as if she'd never been to the lab in the life.
I mean, that's the thing about the Laughing Cavalier. At least he has a giggle, doesn't he?
Yeah, the don't sit there all prissy.
No, mate, no.
Disapproving of you.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, that's dreadful. Yeah. Have you been down to the Rubens?
No.
You haven't seen the Rubens?
No.
Went right over there.
Who's there?
Yes, lovely. He does all the fat ladies with nothing on. Great pink fat ladies.
Yeah.
Except for a tiny little wisp of gauze. Always lands on the appropriate place, if you know. Yeah. Always the wind blows a little bit of gauze over you know where now.
Yeah.
See it down there, can't you?
Of course, you know, it must be a million to one chance, Pete, that the gauze, you know, lands in the right place at the right time.
Yeah.
When he's painting. I bet there's thousands of paintings that we're not allowed to see. Landed in the right place. Yeah. You know, it's on their nose or something.
Yeah.
You both look great, but you still look the same.
Yeah, I guess we do. I used to be a little more plump in those days.
Yes, you look better. But people look better. A lot of people get better looking.
Yeah.
Do you remember some of the old bits of your sketches?
Well, actually, those two characters were our favourite characters, Pete and Dud, or Dud and Pete, whoever got top billing that week. And they started off as two characters in a pub. We just did this story where they were talking about the trouble they had with all these
Women,
you know.
Yeah, they had a lot of trouble with women.
Yeah.
And we were discussing it. Only the other day, I was in lying in bed, you know.
Yeah, nice place to lie.
Best place, in my view. And suddenly, normal thing, tap, tap, tap on the window.
Oh, no. What's that?
A sort of showbiz tap, you know, the alluring come hither, go tap. Away, tap, 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 tap,
yeah.
Tap, that kind of tap. So I thought, bloody hell, who can this be? So I walked over to the window, you know, like I normally do,
I know, I've seen you walk over to the window.
at the time.
Yeah.
I opened the window and who's there? Bloody Greta Garbo. Hanging on to the windowsill saying, Peter, you know that bloody awful Scandinavian voice you had?
Right.
Come with me, let's make love. I said, Greta. You stupid old bat. I said, we've had our laughs, we've had our fun. Say for me, it's over. And I know, but she clung on, I had to poke her off with a broomstick.
Well, it's like me the other night. I come home from work, I was feeling very tuckered out, you know.
Of course you were.
Yeah, of course I was, Pete. Very tuckered out. And made myself a cup of hot chocolate, you know.
Yeah, very nice.
Very nice. And I'm going up the stairs. As I'm going up the stairs, I smell this funny smell. I thought, funny.
Yeah.
You know, maybe I left the gas on. Funny, but it didn't smell, you know, like gas.
It didn't smell like gas, but probably wasn't gas.
Probably wasn't gas.
Yeah.
Okay. So I thought maybe...
Maybe something other than gas.
Maybe Mrs. Woolley had come over and done some light vacuuming in the afternoon.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah, could have been
anyway,
that.
So I went upstairs.
Still with the chocolate.
We're still with the hot chocolate.
Yeah.
I've learned to go up one stair at a time because I used to go up three at a time and I used to get at the top of the stairs and think I'd forgotten to make the hot chocolate. I get into the bedroom, you know, and the smell's getting ridiculous. I put the hot chocolate down,
yeah,
and I open the bed, and skip, really, yeah.
You open the bed?
I pulled back the bedclothes.
Oh, yeah, pulled them right back.
Got inside and put the light out, and suddenly I felt this hand on my cheek.
Yeah, which cheek?
Left upper. I turn on the light and who's there? Jane Russell. Bloody Jane Russell. I said, Jane, get out of my bed.
Yeah.
I said, get out of we've had our laughs, we've had our thrills. I said, it's all over now. I threw her down the stairs through that huge bra after her. I think man has in his infinite understanding made a lot of wonderful things, wonderful inventions for ladies over the years.
Oh, man.
You know?
Yeah.
I mean, he's been prolific. Yeah.
What? Who was it who invented the brassiere?
Oh, the brassiere.
A man.
A man, right.
A man, Dr. Otto Tixley. A well-known Viennese philosopher suddenly said, Eureka, the bra.
Right.
And there it was
there
for
they
them.
Were. And, of course, one must not forget the paper panty.
Who could forget the paper painting?
Because in the old days when, you know, ladies used to have to scrub for hours their drawers over a hot stove, you know, soap and water and a hard brush, brushing their drawers for hours and hours.
Hours and hours.
Whereas now, thanks to the paper painting,
yeah,
all she has to do of an evening is go over them with a rubber.
Pleasure to have you on. Just, and I'm glad the two of you came back together, even just for this minute. Just
thank
lovely.
You.
Thank you. Oh.